Livens. I'm an attorney here in Bedford. I'm also a patient of Dr. K. That's how he and I met about 3 years ago. I got tired, so I came up and kind of did the testing to get energy and all that good stuff. So we've remained friends since then. Just quickly, a little bit about our firm. We're down here in Bedford. We're in Harwood, near Harwood and Central, actually Harwood and Murphy. Been there since 1996. My wife is here with me today. Her name is Lena. She works at the law firm. She does marketing, and actually she does the special needs trust that I'm going to talk about a little bit today. My son-in-law is my partner. My daughter, Lindsay, does our probates, and we have 12 other employees. We have an office in Addison. We have one in Austin. So we've been doing this little gig for a while. I went to SMU Law School. I graduated 28 years ago, and I've been a CPA for the past 32 years. I kind of did a bunch of stuff in the beginning, but for the past 20 years, all we've been doing is trust work, estate planning. We help people with Medicaid and VA benefits for any of your parents. If somebody goes in a nursing home or an assisted living center, you need to come see us because the government will help pay for their care. And then we do the special needs trust. Lena put together some information here for you today. Just a little bio tells you about our firm. This here's a very specific questionnaire regarding a special needs trust that I'll get to in a little bit. And then we have some handouts here about some mistakes that people make when they're doing their planning when they have a special child. So, and kind of the basics of everything is, start out with a will. Everybody needs to have a will. The will says, when I die and go to heaven, I want to give everything to my wife, Lena. If she predeceases me, then I'm going to give it to our children, Lindsay and Jonathan. That's what your will says. It's just a set of instructions. It doesn't help you during your lifetime at all. You would want to have a financial power of attorney if you become disabled while you're alive, and a medical power attorney to make your medical decisions. There's also a directive to physicians, which is the pull your plug document, and then there's that HIPAA release. And we do all those documents, we do all that stuff, and we're happy to help anybody do that. For attending the seminar today, what we offer everyone that comes to one of our seminars, we give them a free complimentary will. It's a $250 value. If you're here today and your husband, you couldn't drag him along, I'll do one for both husband and wife, or if you're single, for you. And that's the basic will. What the catch is, that you'd have to call our office sometime this week, tell the receptionist that you've attended the estate planning seminar at Dr. K's office today. She will email you just kind of a little more general information sheet. All that I really need when I'm going to do a will for somebody is I need to know your complete legal name and your beneficiary's legal names. We don't need social numbers, none of that stuff, but we do need that information. So if you will call our office, Brittany's receptionist, we're open like 8:30 to 5, Monday through Thursday, and 8:30 to 3 on Fridays. They will email you that info sheet. You could fill it out and then bring that in. You'll visit with me or Lena or somebody in our office for like 30 minutes to an hour. It's a free consultation. And then you come back and we'll get you that will done, okay? Don't bring me the one you did off the internet. I'm not going to grade your paper. People like to do that. Don't bring me your LegalZoom will. I'm not going to look at that because here's the deal. You're going to get a brand new 2015 Lexus will done by a lawyer here in town for free. So that's kind of the catch. But when you get past the will and you rise up, there's some more things that I think we could do, Steve. And there is. And I'm going to tell you that the best thing that you can do is you could do a trust. Okay, a trust is nothing more than how you hold title to assets. Okay, so Lena and I, we're married. We could have a bank account down at Chase Bank. It would be owned by Steve and Lena Livens. Lena would be a signer on the account, and I would be a signer on the account. We happen to have created a trust, and there's a bunch of different kinds of trust, but we created a revocable living trust. And so we had to go down to the bank and tell Evelyn, we want to change the name of the Steve and Lena account to the Livens Trust account. And we showed her the book. You have a book that has all the rules in it and everything. And so now everything that we own together, we don't own in our names anymore. It's owned by our trust. The trust is like an open shoebox. We can put things in it. We can take things out. We use our same Social Security number. We do the same tax return. And by the way, down at the bank, we're the signers on the account, but they call us trustees. So when you have a trust, you have the maker. Those people make the trust. That was Lena and I. The trustees are the people that are going to be in charge of the monies. Just happens that we're the trustees also. We wouldn't have to be, but we are.
And then who can benefit from the trust? And they're called the beneficiaries. And while we're alive, Lena and I wear all three hats. So that bank account down there, it's in our trust, we manage it, and can be used for the benefit of Lena and I. So really, during our lifetime, nothing changes in terms of our assets. The house that we live in Grapevine over here near 121 Hall Johnson, the house is in the name of our trust. My car sitting out front is in the name of the trust. Life insurance policies that we have, the beneficiaries name the trust and all that stuff. So, Steve, so that's how the trust works. What are the advantages of the trust? Well, I'm going to tell you kind of a little story. When I and Lena both die and go to heaven, we want our children to benefit from our wealth. And we'll just pretend, say we got $1 million when Lena and I both pass away. And we have two children, Jonathan and Lindsay. And we want to give $500,000 to each one. Okay, now Lindsay is 33. She's the accountant at the firm. She is more frugal than all of us put together. I had to beg her for 5 years to buy a new copier at our law firm. Okay, Jonathan, on the other hand, he's 22. And he only thinks about two things. One has wheels and one has legs. And that's all he cares about. And so when we die, if that were to happen today and we went to heaven, we wouldn't want Jonathan to get his $500,000 because it probably would be gone. And I'm not picking on Jonathan, but just young males, that's kind of the way they are. So what I've decided that when Lena and I ultimately die, we are not going to give our children anything. And so what I've done here, Lindsay, if I died and I gave Lindsay the $500,000 and it went in her purse, people can take money from Lindsay, can't they? If Lindsay does something wrong, if she gets sued, if she has taxes, if she has any creditor issues, the money that I've given Lindsay, now that we're dead and gone, it would be in her purse, it could be taken by her creditors. And more importantly, what I'm really worried about is I'm worried about the son-in-law. I'm worried about divorcing. That's what I'm really worried about. Unfortunately, we live in a country that's got a 60% divorce rate on first marriages, and so you have to assume that if you leave money to your children, that the divorce is a possibility that could happen. And so in order to avoid that, what I'm going to do is when we die, we're going to take Lindsay's $500,000 and it's going to go into her trust, and the lid shuts on this one, and there's Lindsay's money. Now, the difference is if Lindsay goes through a divorce, they can talk about her purse, can't they? But they can't talk about this because this is not owned by Lindsay. It's owned by a trust, and we can name it anything we want. We just named this one the Lindsay Trust. We could call this the ABC Trust. We could call this the Lindsay Loving Trust. We can call it anything we want, but Lindsay does not own it. And that's a very big, important key. And I think of the 8 reasons to do a living trust, that to me is the most important one. So, Lena and I have passed away. The $500,000 goes into the trust for Lindsay. The lid shuts. Now, I don't have one for Jonathan here, but he would have one also. And what I'm going to do with Lindsay, remember, we've got to have a trustee, right? Somebody's got to be in charge of it. Okay, remember, Lindsay's very frugal and very tight. Lindsay, you can be in charge of your own money. So she'll be the signer on that account. But she can only take the money out for health, education, maintenance, and support. Those are the only 4 reasons that she can take it out. The initials or the acronym is HEMS, H-E-M-S. Not D for divorce, not C for creditor, not I for IRS. Nobody can make her take that money out. If they come to her and they say, hey, you know, you hit the school bus and you got sued and you owe us $1 million, we want your trust, she can say, hey, I don't own the trust. She doesn't. The trust has its own federal ID number, yada, yada, yada. And so that to me is the main reason to do a trust. Now, Jonathan's maybe my special child. So what would I do with Jonathan? Well, I could do the same thing if I had a special child. Okay, we could take the $500,000 and we could put it in Jonathan's trust. We could shut the lid. But we want to have some different rules on the game, wouldn't we? When you have a special child, we have to have some special rules. Basically, just going to summarize it, the difference between Lindsay's trust and Jonathan's trust are, number one, Jonathan can't be in charge of his money. Special needs trust. The beneficiary cannot be in charge of the money. And the second rule of the game is, whoever that trustee is, remember the trustee's the babysitter, the one's in charge of the money, they cannot give cash directly to Jonathan. That's the only rules of the game. So if Jonathan's our special child and we want him to continue to be eligible for Medicaid benefits as he becomes a young adult and progresses through life, but still we want to provide for him, we would take the money, put it into a special needs trust, shut the lid, and have somebody else be the trustee. Could be Lindsay, could be my brother, could be Chase Bank, could be Charles Schwab, could be Merrill Lynch. You can name a trustee, anybody you want, to manage the money. The only rules of the game are, is that, remember, they cannot give money directly to the child. That's a no-no. And the child cannot be in charge of the money. So that's what we would do with our planning if we had a special child. And even if we don't, I still profess that you should never give anybody any money. Now, what's your name, young lady?
Lois.
Lois? Lotus. L-O-D or L-O-I? Lois, okay. All right, well, Lois, I married Delene over there. And, you know, I didn't give Lindsay any money when I died, did I? Do you remember why I didn't give it to her? Well, I was worried about the divorce thing, right? But creditors and IRS taxes and all that stuff. Well, long before Lindsay gets her money, Lena's probably going to get some money. I'm probably going to go first, right? Okay, and when I go first, if I go ahead and I give the money to my wife, Lena, okay, we've got $1 million, right? Remember, that's what I said. If I die tonight, my $500,000, I get to direct how I want it to go. And with the will, it goes into the purse right here, right? Okay, and Lena then will be walking around. Well, Lena moved on me. Where'd she go? Well, there she is. Lena will be walking around, and she'll have her $500,000 and my $500,000 in this purse. And my problem is I'm afraid she might meet the tennis pro. And if she meets the tennis pro and she falls head over heels, she'll never be in love with him like she was with me. But if she marries the tennis pro and they get divorced, I got the same dang problem, right? Remember, her money, people can take money out of the purses. So because I didn't give Lindsay any money, I ain't giving Lena a dime either. So when I die, 500 grand goes into the Livens Trust. And here, Lena. Lena can be in charge of the money, but the rules of the game say what? She can only take the money out for her health, education, maintenance, or support. Maintenance is the one that basically she can take the money out for any reason at all. But there's no D in there for divorce. There's no I for IRS. There's no C for creditor. And so Lena can drink from the well, take the money out, invest to do whatever she wants. And then when she dies, then this trust would go away. And Lindsay's and Jonathan then will fill up with the gas. They're like cars. The gas is the money. The gas goes in them and away you go. And that's how it works. Yes, young lady.
So each of those are three different trusts. You have the Livens trust.
Yeah. And when we do the trust, we didn't bring a trust along, but they're kind of like they're big books. And, you know, phase one is the revocable living trust. That's where Lena and I are today. Phase two would be where one of us goes to heaven, right? I don't know who's going first, but statistically I'm going to go first. So my $500,000 goes into a second trust. So all Lena would do, she'd get on Chase Bank, say, Evelyn, Steve finally left this world and went to heaven. Give me half the account, $500,000, and let's put it in a new bank account called the Stephen Livens Trust. So she'd put $500,000 in there. Now she'll get two bank statements from Chase Bank. The original trust, that has $500 in it, and the trust that I have has $500 in it. She's in charge of both of them. Okay, do you know if I died today, do you know when Lena would die?
Do I know when she would die?
Yeah, if I died today, do you know when she would die? Tonight of a broken heart. She died tonight of a broken heart. And as a result, then tomorrow, both trusts would collapse, and then Lindsay's $500,000 would go in hers, and Jonathan's would go in his. And that would be our estate plan. Now, a couple other things about the money that's in Lindsay and Jonathan's trust. You know, that's really my money, right? So I got some rules in that game. And I said, you know, Lindsay and Jonathan, if there's any money left in your trust when you guys go to heaven, guess where it's going? It ain't going to the Moonies. And it ain't going to the son-in-law and the daughter-in-law. It's going to our children, grandchildren. It's going to stay in our bloodline. And I don't feel guilty doing that because that's our money, right? And by doing that, those funds are not going to be included in Jonathan and or Lindsay's estate for estate tax purposes. So there's a whole bunch of reasons to do it. Okay, that's the basic estate plan. So I'm going to talk a little bit more specifically about special needs trust. Yes, Obo.
The M in the HEM, what does that
stand for? Maintenance.
Maintenance.
Health, education, maintenance, And support. Support is any duties of support that you may have for your dependents. Those are the reasons that you can take money out of the trust. Now, I'm going to tell you, if you did do a trust with me, I always encourage the parents to bring their children in for a follow-up meeting, which is complimentary, so I can tell the kids this. Lindsay, when mom and dad pass away and go to heaven and this trust is created, and we don't tell them how much money they're going to get, but this trust is in here, don't you ever take money out of this trust. She goes, what do you mean? I thought it's mine. I can spend it. Yes, if you want to take money out and spend it, do that. If you want to take the money out and go on a vacation, you want to pay for your kids' education, you know, do that. But if you wanted to buy a new house, don't take the money out of the trust and buy the house. Let the trust buy the house. You got it? We want everything in the safety of the trust. And remember, the trust is just nothing more than how you hold title. So if Lindsay wants to buy a condo in Cocoa Beach, Florida, like my wife wants to, okay, she should have the trust buy it. So the money would come out of the trust, buy the Cocoa Beach condo, and the Cocoa Beach condo would go back in the trust. As long as it's in there, no creditors can ever get it, and mainly I'm looking at the divorce issue, correct? So once I explain the kids that, I say, Lindsay, you can do anything you want with it. You know, if you want to buy some American Airlines stock, buy it. You can go open up an account at Schwab or Fidelity. You can buy life insurance. You can do anything you want with the money, but just hold ownership in the name of the trust. Don't ever hold it in your name individually, because individually, if you get sued in Texas, they can take anything they find of yours except your house, your retirement account, some life insurance and annuities, and $30,000 worth of my junk. My junk is clothing, furniture, things like that. But they can take anything above $30,000 if you're married, anything above $60,000. Okay? Yes, sir.
When you pass away, does the trust that's been set up, does that become irrevocable?
Yes. Okay. Question is, the trust, Stephen, is it irrevocable? Okay, I never used that term before. What I said was, during phase one, when Lena and I are alive, we got an open shoebox, okay? If this was the revocable living trust, the lid is open on it all during our lifetime. So Lena and I can put things in, we can take things out, it's under our social number, yada, yada, yada. But during phase two, this one down here, when that trust gets set up and we put the money in it, the lid shuts. It's irrevocable. The terms of the trust cannot be changed. Remember I said Lena is the beneficiary, health, education, maintenance, support, yada, yada, yada. Lena's the trustee. If she can't do it, I got my brother Gene and then Michael and then the bank and so on and so forth. So all those rules, that's an irrevocable trust. Because it's irrevocable, that's why the creditors can't make Lena give her the money, because the rules say you can't do that. And the same thing with the children's trust. They're irrevocable trust too. But we have instructions in the trust that says, upon the death of the second spouse, the trust will collapse, and then new sub-trusts will be created, one for Lindsay and one for Jonathan. Okay? Yes, young lady. Yes. Yeah. Well, I'm gonna give us a choice on that in a minute, but let's get the basics covered. But the answer to that is yes. You get to choose who you want. And remember, during phase one, when Lena and I are both alive, the box is open. We can change the rules. You know, if we want to disinherit Lindsay totally altogether, we can. If we have another child and we want to add another trust, or, you know, sometimes you have bad children, but you want to take care of the grandkids. And so there's all kinds of different options that you have. I think one of the biggest misconceptions that people have when they come to talk to me is they don't know what they can do. They think, well, don't I have to give it to my wife and then to the kids? No, you don't have to. You can do anything you want. You know, I hate dealing with engineers because they come in and they get all complicated formulas and, you know, the kid can take 10% out if they're not married but only on Sundays and past midnight, you know? I mean, and you can recognize an engineer or an IT guy when they come in because they ask you all these technical questions. So that's the plan. Now, another great thing about the trust, you can avoid the probate process, okay? The probate process is a court downtown Tarrant County. We have probate court number one and probate court number two. They handle all wills and guardianships and things like that. When you have a will, you have to take the will down to the courthouse, file it, hire a lawyer, pay generally somewhere $3,000 plus to have that will read by the judge, admitted to court, and given somebody the authority to transfer assets. Now, the probate, the reason you have to do it is because there's an asset that's in the dead guy's name, the house. Steve and Lena own the house. This is assuming I have no trust, right? Steve and Lena own the house. So when I die and go to heaven, Lena can live in the house forever, but if she ever goes to sell the house, the title company's going to say, well, where's Steven? She's going to say, well, that old dirty dog went to heaven a long time ago. They're going to say, well, did you probate? She's going to say, no. They're going to say, you got to go to court and get a court order so you can transfer the ownership of the house. So probate is just something you have to do when you have assets in the deceased person's name that you can't get a hold of. Now, if we own the house jointly with rights of survivorship, then it would go to her. If we owned a bank account together, Lena or I, she could get that, couldn't she? If I had a life insurance policy that named her as the beneficiary, done it to probate. But I'm rushed for time here today. But so a trust, once you take all those assets out of my name, there's nothing in my name, then there's no need to ever have to go to the courthouse with a will and get it probated. Now, we always include a will as a backup safety net. But that's another benefit of doing a trust. People will say, well, probate's not a big deal in Texas. It's not a big deal in Texas compared to California. California, you die with an $800,000 estate, you're going to spend about $80,000 in cost to get that will probated. The state of California takes 5%, and the lawyers get like 4.8%. So on an $800,000 estate, you're going to lose 80 grand. In Texas, it doesn't matter what your estate is. I have to do 7 documents. I have to go to the courthouse with you one time. In our firm, we charge a flat fee, generally about $3,000 or $4,000, and that's it. So that's not a big deal compared to California. But $4,000 is still a big deal, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Wouldn't it be nice not to have to spend the $4,000 when I die and the $4,000 when she dies, right? Because you got 2 spouses. And if you have it all in a trust, you can avoid 2 probates. Yes, young lady.
Why a will when you trust?
The only reason not to do the trust is because you got to write me a bigger check. That's the only reason. People say to me, Stephen, what's the catch? Okay, and then I want to tell you too, trusts are not the same. You know, you walk in Barnes & Noble and they got books all over the place, but they all look the same. Why is one book $2 and one book $60? Because of what's in the book. And so I'm going to tell you that all living trusts are not the same. We have phase number 1. Everybody does that one. Phase number 2 offers you creditor protection for your spouse and tax planning. And then phase 3 plans for your dynasty of your children. A lot of trusts only have phase 1. They don't have 2 and 3 on it. So you've got to be careful what you're getting. Phase 1, because the lid's open and it's revocable. And that's why there's no creditor protection other than the house, the retirement plan, life insurance annuities, and $60,000 worth of our junk because we're married. I'm reluctant to say fees. Because here's the deal. Here's the deal. When you say somebody that I've done somewhere between 2 and 3,000 trust, they think 2 and 3,000 trust. So if I say a trust costs somewhere between $1 and $300, do you know what you remember? 100. You come in and I charge you 301 and say what? No, the trust costs several thousand dollars. Generally, you're going to spend somewhere between 2 and 6,000 doing an estate plan. You still come out ahead, yeah, but you got to pay the money now. I want to talk about the special needs trust, though, and get down to that a little bit because that's really the main focus today. So now that we've got the basics of our estate plan, What are we going to do with our special child? Well, why do we need to be concerned? We need to be concerned because when our child turns 18, if they have more than $2,000 in savings, now income is different than savings, right? Okay, but if they have more than $2,000 in savings in their name, no Medicaid. That's the game. Same thing if you go to the nursing home. Same rule. Person that goes in the nursing home, they don't get nursing home Medicaid coverage if they have more than $2,000 in assets. Don't count a home, don't count a car. There's some things you don't count. But basically, let's go back to Jonathan. If he's our special child, and I want to provide for him when we go to heaven, and I want him to have the benefit of the $500,000, if I give it to him, he's done, right? He's got more than $2,000. And so he'd have to report that to social services. They would then cut off his benefits, and he would no longer have the Medicaid benefit. So what we want to do is we want to be able to put money aside for the benefit of Jonathan, but we don't want him to lose his government benefit. And so that's what I'm here to mainly talk about today. What do you do? Well, you can look at the costly mistake things here. you know, I've got people that don't know that there's things that they can do. Remember, I think the big mistake is people don't know what they can do, right? Okay. So I'll have some people who say, well, I'm going to give it all to Lindsay, and I've talked to her, and she's going to take care of her brother Jonathan. Let me tell you, that never works. Not only does it not work because of Lindsay, but then Lindsay's got a husband, and then when Lindsay starts spending money on Jonathan, there's gift taxes and all kinds of implications. I'll have people who say, well, Jonathan's going to need more than Lindsay, so we're going to give it all to Jonathan, and I'm not going to give anything to Lindsay. You know, and you can do whatever you kind of feel is best for your child. Unfortunately, I can't not help you, you know, with who's going to be the caretakers. Those are really difficult decisions that you have to make. But in the terms of the money part of it, we can do it. So there are a couple different types of special needs trust. There's two types mainly. There's a third-party special needs trust, and there's a self-settled trust. And here's what the difference is. A self-settled trust is a special needs trust that is created, and Jonathan puts his money in it. So your disabled child, it's their money, and they put the money in the trust. When would that happen? Well, if you had like a lawsuit pending, there was a car accident, medic malpractice or something, and your child, you know, is suing somebody and they get money, that's what you have to do. You have to go back to the courthouse and you have to get the judge to create a self-settled special needs trust so that Jonathan's assets, once again, are down below $2,000 because the trust won't count. And he can benefit from that. So the self-settled trust is with Jonathan's money. The bad news about the self-settled trust is that there has to be a payback provision in there. So whatever benefits Jonathan gets during his lifetime, they will keep track of that. And whenever he has any money, or he dies and goes to heaven, any money that's in that trust that's remaining is going to be paid back to Medicaid for all those government benefits that he received. So self-settled, payback. We don't really want to do that. What we're going to do is we're going to do the other one, the third-party special needs trust. And that's what I described up here today. Phase one, phase two, phase three. This phase three is a third-party special needs trust. Lean and I are the third parties. We're taking our money and we're putting it in there. And by doing that, you don't have to have that payback provision. So what we would do with Jonathan's money and his trust, you can do whatever you want, but the choices mainly are, if there's any money left in there when Jonathan goes to heaven, it's going to go to his issue, would be my first choice. The second choice would be to his siblings, meaning our other children. And then the third choice, we could name whoever we want to do that. So that's what we've done. We've said that either trust for either of our children, if there's any money left in there, they can't give it to, you know, Chad's my son-in-law. He's my law partner, kind of my best friend, but I ain't giving him nothing. If he was here, he does this seminar too. When he tells a story, he says, yeah, Lindsay's dad ain't getting nothing. So we all know that. But yeah, we're not going to do that. So in the third party discretionary special needs trust, we set the thing up. Our money goes in there, and then those funds can be used for Jonathan's care. The only rule, two rules. Jonathan can't be in charge of the money, right? And the second thing is you can never give any money directly to Jonathan. Now, I'm going to tell you a little side note. I just came back from an elder law seminar in Austin. I belong to a group called NALA, National Academy of Law Attorneys. And there's a charge card now, a debit card called TrueLink, that you can get for special children. And I'm going to get one of these for my wife because you can limit what vendors can take that card. And they were specifically talking about alcohol and Walgreens. You can actually go in and say that this is authorized to charge Walgreens. You can put a dollar limit on it. It'll send you an automatic text if they try to go ahead and charge them. That's just a side note. It's called TrueLink. I think I have some information on it. I just came back from the office. So that would be something that you might think about doing. But getting back on course here, the third-party special needs trust, what we recommend is that we create that trust today, right now. You don't wait till we're dead and gone. And why do I want to create it right now? Well, I want to create the trust right now because my mother might want to give Jonathan some money. You know, at Christmas time, how she gives everybody $500? She's not been giving Jonathan the money because he's a special child and he can't have more than $2,000, so she never gives him any money. So if we had the special needs trust created, she might put the Christmas gift and we could put it in that special needs trust. The other thing too, my mother, I told her when she dies and goes to heaven, I don't want any of her money. I mean, I really don't. Lena works me like a dog. We've got enough money and no money. So I told my mother when she dies to give the money to our children. So we've created the special needs trust for Jonathan. So all she had to do was tell her lawyer in Iowa, you know, one half goes to Lindsay's trust and one half goes to Jonathan's trust. So that trust is created now today. Another reason to do it today is to kind of test the waters. What do you mean by that? Well, if I was going to do it today, I would create the special needs trust. Even if you don't do a will or any of that other stuff, you can still do the standalone special needs trust. You create the trust, and you put $2,001 in the trust. So you create the trust, we get a federal ID number, you go down to Chase Bank, talk to Evelyn, say I want to open up a special needs savings account, here's $2,001. Why do I say 2001? Because remember, 2000 is the limit, right? So as soon as we put 2001 in there, I'm going to take the trust and the bank statement, and I'm going to send it off to Social Security. And I'm going to say, just want to let y'all know, Jonathan's got a special needs trust, and by the way, here's the trust and here's the bank statement. And you're never going to hear back from them. They don't call you up and say, yeah, thanks, we got the trust. But by the mere fact that we sent it to them and we were over the $2,000, they have the duty and the obligation to review the trust, right? So now, 20 years later, when Lena and I die and $500,000 comes into the trust, they're going to look at the trust then. And we're going to say, whoa, 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 you guys got to look at it 20 years ago. We sent it to you. Here's the certified card where we all received it. Because if they come back and they say, that trust is no good, we already gave them the opportunity to tell us it wasn't, right? And I tell you that because, and Lena will agree with me, I think, on this, about half of the special needs trusts that people bring into us to review are wrong, aren't they?
Yes.
They, most of them will allow the trustee to make payments directly to the beneficiary. And when Social Security gets hold of that, they're going to deny it. They're going to say it's not a valid trust. I'd rather them tell me that with $2,001 in there at risk than $500,000, right? Okay. Another thing you could do, get the special needs trust set up. You could go buy a life insurance policy. And you could name the special needs trust the beneficiary. So now when I die and go to heaven, you know, if I've got a $500,000 or $1 million policy and I've got the special needs trust named as the beneficiary, the funds go directly from the insurance company right into Jonathan's trust. It's a nice way to fund it. Another thing that people will do is if they have a child that's over 18 and they're living at home, once they're over 18 and living at home, you do not have a duty any longer to support them. So guess what? You charge them rent. $50, $200, $500, whatever you want to charge them, and you could put the money into the trust, and you could buy that life insurance policy and fund that policy with whatever payments you got coming in for the rent on the house. Okay, now the only time we kind of do that is we'll have people come into us, and they'll have a child that's in their early 20s, and they got $15,000 in the bank, and they're concerned, what can they do with it? Well, we got to get rid of the 15, but the child can't give it away, so a legitimate way to do it, well, let's charge the child rent. And so there's a whole bunch of, and I can't go through all the scenarios today, but if you come up with the scenario, everybody's fact pattern is going to be a little bit different. But if you come in and visit with us, Lena and I know we've got all kinds of ideas of things to do. We've been doing this for well over 20 years. Probably you've done a couple thousand special needs trusts.